night of June 3rd, 1989, tanks and armored vehicles of the People's Liberation Army moved into Beijing and put an end to 7 weeks of peaceful protest.
After the shooting on the night of June 3rd, when I found out that so many people had died, I felt neither anger nor sorrow, nothing. I was completely numb. There was a huge emptiness. I just couldn't believe they would open fire.
In the first few days after my son was killed, many friends, colleagues, and students came to express their sympathy. They all said that soon the official verdict would be overturned. But as investigations and arrests began, fewer and fewer people came to see me. When people ran into me, they were silent. It was as though nothing had ever happened.
Events do not deliver their meanings to us. They are always interpreted. On the morning of June 5th, there was a moment that would come to symbolize the hope and the tragedy of those spring days. He disappeared into the crowd afterwards, and no one knows where he is now. No one is even certain of his name. But for the millions who saw this scene all over the world, its meaning was clear. Here was human hope and courage challenging the remorseless machinery of state power. The Chinese government interpreted this scene just as simply, but differently. In the days after the end of the protest at Tiananmen, large numbers of people were arrested all over China.
I heard the government's most wanted list on the radio. At first it seemed only students were on the list, but I finally heard my own name. I couldn't stand the humiliation of being hunted down by the police. I wanted to maintain as much dignity as possible while facing the inevitable. So I decided to go to the police on my own. I told the police, "I've come here because you've got your facts wrong. I don't know if it's deliberate or because you don't understand what really happened. Since I was involved, I feel it's my duty to straighten you out."
When individuals stand up to power, they bring to the encounter the lessons the power has taught them and the harm it has done them. Merely to stand up does not free us from these things. Behind every gesture of hope and courage lies a life, a society, a history. Tiananmen, the Gate of Heavenly Peace, is the gate leading into the Imperial City, for centuries the center of power in China. In 1919, though the emperor had long been overthrown, students gathered at Tiananmen to denounce the government's failure to stand up to foreign powers. Their protest spread quickly through the country and came to be known as the May 4th movement. Years of student demonstrations followed. Despite violent government repression, arrests, and killings, generation after generation, the students came out to protest, inspiring other Chinese to follow them. China was in danger, and corrupt officials didn't care. Young intellectuals felt they must place their lives on the line to awaken the people. They aimed to save the nation through democracy and modern science and the discarding of oppressive traditions. When the great change did come, it came from the countryside, a peasant army led in part by people who had participated in the student protests. Mao Zedong's communist army entered Beijing in 1949. National power returned to the city, and to Tiananmen. The traditional rulers of China had always remained hidden behind the closed gates of the imperial city. When Mao appeared before the people atop Tiananmen, he reversed centuries of symbolism. The center of power was visibly shifted from the imperial city behind the gate to the broad masses in front, all facing the leader who stood above.
Before the founding ceremonies of the People's Republic of China in 1949, Tiananmen Square was full of weeds as high as your waist. Students from Beijing and Tsinghua universities volunteered to clear away all the weeds. Yes, it was students then too. At that time, young people were very enthusiastic about the People's Liberation Army and about the revolution. It was at Tiananmen that the People's Republic of China was founded. It was at Tiananmen that Mao announced, "The Chinese people have stood up."
When I was a child, I went to Tiananmen twice a year for the parades. Mao stood on Tiananmen Gate. After the parade had passed, a huge crowd of children would rush up to the gate, shouting joyfully. No words, just the sound of children's voices. This created the desired effect. I was one of those children. I would wave flowers or release balloons or doves. Mao would wave his hand like this. At that time, many communist leaders moved into quarters within the old imperial city. Before, they had lived with the peasants, and it was said, fish cannot live out of water. But after the revolution, if a peasant went into the city to look up a leader he had known in the past, he wouldn't be able to find him. The water could no longer find the fish. The fish were inside the palace. And Mao himself became, in effect, the emperor, hailed as a man who would live forever. Of course, I was unable to see it like this in the 1950s.
In the 1950s, the government ordered the building of a great square in front of Tiananmen to accommodate the masses. Several of China's later leaders first came to prominence as dedicated model workers in the building of the square. The gigantic square would become the largest public space in the world and the center of Chinese political life. On one side of it was built a great hall of the people, on the other, a museum of history and the revolution. In the center of the square stood the monument commemorating the martyrs of the revolution, a tombstone of the great dead, which consecrates the square as sacred ground. The monument depicts scenes from China's history since 1840. There are no recognizable individuals. Collectively, they represent the people. Among the ancestors of New China pictured on the monument are the students of May 4th, 1919, protesting before the gate itself. When the students of 1989 occupied Tiananmen Square, they made their headquarters here, beneath images of other students who changed China's history. They were consciously associating themselves with the tradition of student protest in China. By their own actions, they were adding further meaning to this place, the place in all of China most charged with meaning.
Good morning, beloved Peking. Good morning, beloved Tiananmen, Gate of Heavenly Peace.
In Mao's era, Tiananmen became the symbol of the new China, the gate and the square, the people, and the leader who expressed the people's will. Tiananmen had once led into the imperial palace. Now, it was the focus of Mao's square. Mao, and Tiananmen were one.
Tiananmen Square became completely entangled with the lives of the Chinese people. This was because under the Communist Party, everyone's life became involved with politics. When I graduated from university in 1966, I sincerely believed what I was taught, that I was a brand new boat to be used in the construction of the great mansion of communism. I was willing to be put wherever my country needed me, and I was prepared to stay in place my whole life. To me, Mao was like God. I believed that he was not only the great leader of the Chinese people, but also the great leader of people throughout the world. I feared the day when he would no longer be with us. I really hoped there'd be a scientific breakthrough that would enable young people like us to voluntarily give up a year of our lives to add a minute to his. That way the world would be saved.
In 1976, Mao died between an earthquake and a solar eclipse, traditional portents of the end of an era. At the funeral, the great throng faced Tiananmen, but the place where Mao had stood was empty. All of the leaders remained on a platform below. Mao still resides in the square. The mausoleum built in 1977 at the south end of the square is not a tomb so much as a grand villa. It contains a huge marble armchair for the chairman and a bed too, where he lies.
I didn't shed a single tear when Mao died. I felt I'd been cheated. I've never visited the Mao mausoleum. It's so disgusting.
Mao is dead, but not gone. The great portrait that hangs on Tiananmen still presides over every parade and celebration held in the Great Square. During the student demonstrations of 1989, three men from Mao's own home province of Hunan splattered the great portrait with ink. The students immediately distanced themselves from this act. They denounced the outrage and helped arrest the men responsible. Shortly after the desecration, gale-force winds blew and torrents of rain fell on the square. Some people actually wondered, was the chairman displeased? Within hours, the portrait was replaced. But it is not only Mao's face. His vision of history, his language, his actions still loom large in China's imagination.
Communism is actually a promise of something perfect. It's easy for people who are dissatisfied with all the imperfections of real life to be attracted to it. During the 1930s and 40s, many people were drawn to the Communist Party because they wanted to escape the ugly reality, and they longed for the promise.
Throughout the first decade of the revolution, that promise had the support of large segments of society. Mao provided the vision of an ideal society, but he had little interest in the day-to-day work of bringing it about. That was left to his associates. Among them was Deng Xiaoping.
Mao had the personality of a romantic poet. Deng's is that of a pragmatist. He's not a puritanical theoretician or an idealist. He's different from Mao in that he knows that when people are hungry, they need to eat. They can't live on poetry. During the 1950s, Mao launched wave after wave of persecutions against people who held different views. By 1959, no one dared express any dissenting opinions anymore. He had to have the last word on everything. And people would have tolerated it if his policies had worked out well. But he made a mess of things. Millions of people starved to death.
So his comrades had to help patch things up. This meant a slight retreat from Mao's utopian illusions.
Deng liked to quote a Sichuan proverb, "It doesn't matter whether a cat is black or white. If it catches mice, it's a good cat." But Mao's solution, when things went wrong, was always more revolution, not less. He saw anyone who stood between him and his masses as an enemy. He saw bureaucrats and lingering bourgeois elements undermining the original promise of the revolution. Against the government bureaucracy, Mao mobilized his masses. A fresh uprising of the people, the only source of progress. Mao called it a cultural revolution. The people were enjoying Da Min Ju, mass democracy. Chaos can't harm us, he proclaimed. It can only harm our enemies. Mao lost control of the Cultural Revolution. It became a war of all against all. Deng Xiaoping was among those attacked. Mao stripped him of his power, then brought him back to repair a shattered society. Like those in power who had experienced Mao's mass democracy, Deng Xiaoping's greatest fear would be Dong Luan, turmoil, chaos, upheaval. When the students of 1989 took to the streets, they too were branded as stirring up Dong Luan. Many leaders in the government saw them in the light of the past. They were a throwback to the horrors of the Cultural Revolution that had nearly destroyed China. At the end of the Cultural Revolution, the Chinese economy was on the verge of bankruptcy. What could be done? Now here's where Deng Xiaoping was really smart. His prescription was capitalism. Reform and opening up actually meant learning from capitalism. But he couldn't say that outright, because capitalism was supposed to be our arch enemy. Now, how could you turn around and learn from our enemy? So Deng came up with something called socialism with Chinese characteristics.
He followed his instincts. First and foremost, the people didn't have enough to eat. They had to be fed. Secondly, the people who had been politically wronged had to be exonerated. These were very practical things. Little did he know what tremendous changes would be triggered once this process began.
It was deep winter, 1979, when a thaw began to be felt. A stretch of bare wall near the city center became a place where people posted their hopes and fears about the new China. There were a dozen unofficial journals, too, and new voices heard. A young man named Wei Jingsheng wrote a poster. What China needed was more than the four modernizations the government was promoting in agriculture, industry, science, and defense. China needed a fifth modernization, democracy. Democracy wasn't the result of progress, Wei Jingsheng argued. It was a precondition for progress. Meanwhile, Deng Xiaoping was on the road. Apparently moving away from communist ideology, Deng was welcomed in America. Time magazine named him Man of the Year. In the U.S., China's economic reforms were greeted with enthusiasm.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States and His Excellency Deng Xiaoping, the Vice Premier of the State Council of the People's Republic of China.
High. Rocky Mountain High. Mr. Vice Premier, it is with great joy that we welcome you to our country.
And it is with true love that we extend our very best wishes to you and your people on your new long march toward modernization in this century. I thank you very much, Kwe To Chen. Thank you.
Deng Xiaoping went to America, and soon after, hope came to China.
Hey, we're off on the road to China with fun and adventure in mind. The seventh wonder of the world is here beneath our feet. Compared to this, the road to Mandalay is obsolete.
Hey, this is it, Peking, China. Amazing, isn't it? Just 10 years ago, who would have dreamt an American comedian would be standing here in Tiananmen Square saying whatever he pleased and photographing anything he pleased. But in this fast-moving world, radical changes can occur overnight. Take a look at this square, almost 100 acres. Looks like Jackie Gleason's patio. Now they can get 1.5 million people in here. Of course, they're not here today. Nobody knew I was coming.
Americans felt an enormous relief. The Chinese are, after all, just like us. They want what we want, and maybe we can sell it to them. But even as China and the U.S. swapped celebrities and made deals, the dark gates closed on others. For his warning that Deng might become a new dictator, Wei Jingsheng was framed and sentenced to 15 years. He was still in prison when the students came to Tiananmen in 1989 to demand democracy. Few of them knew his story.
In China, if you wanted to express your opinions, you had to speak from within the Communist Party. If you talked outside, they'd throw you in jail. The only option for a pure idealist is to commit suicide. I once wrote an essay entitled, Commit Suicide and Save the Country. Of course, it didn't pass the censors. I completely lost faith in the Communist Party. I thought the only workable thing was to join up and try and change it. Committing suicide myself wouldn't do the country much good. A more useful thing to do was to help the Communist Party commit suicide. Lenin had taught us that the easiest way to take a fortress is from within. There's also the Trojan horse in ancient Greece. If you can't win through confrontation, you have to try sneaking inside. That someone like myself could join the party was because cracks had already appeared. Before Deng's reforms, someone like me would never have been let in.
Now begins the Grand Mass Parade to celebrate the 35th anniversary of the founding of the People's Republic of China.
By 1984, when the People's Republic marked its 35th anniversary, there was something new to celebrate, the success of Deng Xiaoping's reforms. Once, Deng had been purged by Mao for his disobedience. Now, Deng was no longer under the great teacher's shadow. He could make his own plans, and he had the power to execute them. He would be called the grand architect of reform. By Deng's side were his loyal ministers, Hu Yabong, Zhao Ziyang, men given the task of reform, men who can also be blamed when reform went too far. Some students in the parade raised a homemade banner greeting Deng by his first name. Hello, Xiaoping, an unheard-of liberty. People were genuinely grateful to Deng.
China's industry is advancing toward modernization. Like agriculture, it will soon be carried forward on the wave of reform.
The early reforms brought quick and dramatic change. In the countryside, communes were broken up. Rural markets were revived. Farmers started to make money. There was a lot more money to be made. The old men in charge were changing China. the results were going to be seen everywhere. After decades of relative isolation, China was looking outward to the world. Just ahead, all the enticements of capitalism beckon.
Our life is getting better and better. The light industry float shows how life is becoming more colorful as our living standards rise.
The National Day celebrations in 1984 were an elaborate, enthusiastic affair. Many people saw a bright future ahead. But why did my friends and I feel so depressed? The overcast sky, the lone figure of Deng Xiaoping popping out of that car, riding stern-faced down Chang'an Avenue. I thought it all boded ill for the future. That kind of spectacle was the heritage of the Mao era. It was an embodiment of revolution. And for us, revolution was made up of a small number of ambitious political careerists on the one hand, and the frenzied masses on the other. And we were fed up with all that. A measure of economic prosperity had been achieved by 1984, but we saw countless difficulties ahead, and we didn't know how heavy a price the Chinese people might still have to pay. All I could do was to help change things bit by bit. I knew I couldn't make that much difference, but that didn't matter, because there was nothing else worth doing anyway.
Singing and dancing, 1.5 million people in the capital attend the Grand National Day Evening Carnival. The carnival evening will forever remain in our memories. Come to see Tiananmen, come to see our country in 5 years' time.
On May 28, 1989, a student leader named Chai Ling requested an interview with an American journalist. Tiananmen Square was then occupied by students. Martial law had been declared. No one knew what might happen. The interview was recorded with a home video camera.
These may be my last words, because the situation is becoming very grim. My name is Chai Ling. I am 23 years old. Oddly enough, my birthday is on April 15th, the day Hu Yaobang died.
Hu Yaobang had been the general secretary of the party and Deng Xiaoping's chosen successor. Public mourning for Hu would last for a week and would become the ground from which all the demonstrations of 1989 would grow.
In many ways, the movement is not very mature. An opportunity presented itself accidentally. No one knew Hu Yaobang was going to die when he did. This movement is a great manifestation of the natural democratic instincts of the students.
When I came out of the Great Hall of the People, I saw a huge crowd gathered in Tiananmen Square. I wanted to go over to them, but there were 9 rows of police standing between us.
The students had brought their petition and demanded that Li Peng, the prime minister, come out to accept it himself.
When we saw our classmates kneeling there, holding the petition with raised arms, everyone cried. In it were our suggestions to the government, but we had to hand it in kneeling down. No one paid any attention. No one came forward to accept it.
We all saw those three students. We workers felt, Premier, you should come out. You should accept the petition and answer their demands. Even if you don't agree, you should at least make some gesture. But the Premier just left. He completely ignored the students. Now, how do you expect people to take that? How could the government be so callous? Many of us who had just gathered inside the Great Hall had taken part in student movements when we were young. So why were we treating the students this way now?
During those early days of the student movement, we pleaded with the authorities, petitioned them like loyal subjects in traditional China. At first we made direct appeals. Then we pleaded with tears and on bended knee. Yes, we were even willing to kneel down before them, like subjects petitioning the emperor. We had to beg them to come out and talk to us. But then again, it's fair to say that the government virtually crumbled under the weight of our knees.
What the students were opposing now were the very same things we had opposed in our youth. Why had we turned into a party which was against the people and the students? This was not the same Communist Party I had once joined.
Good evening. Thousands of Chinese students took to the streets today in defiance of a government ban on public protests. The students' chant was for democracy. Their demands for political reform. The backdrop was a memorial service for fallen leader Hu Yaobang.
I was in New York at the time. This sort of news was on television and in the papers every day. When friends got together, all we talked about were these events. The TV images affected me deeply. I thought, what's the use of getting all worked up about it if you're so far away? I had to go back. So I got on a plane leaving New York on April 26th. When I was changing planes in Tokyo, I met someone who had just come from China. He said, what do you think you can do back there? Haven't you heard about the editorial that just appeared? It calls the movement a plot by a small handful to instigate anti-party, anti-state Dongluan.
Dongluan. Turmoil, upheaval, chaos. A People's Daily editorial denounced the demonstrations. We must unequivocally oppose Dongluan, the headline read. Such an editorial, appearing in the official Communist Party media, amounted to a charge of criminal conspiracy.
It was dangerous for me to go back. I even asked about flights returning to New York. But then I heard the boarding announcement for my flight to Beijing. I didn't have time to hesitate. I had to get on that plane. I thought, what the heck? Live or die, I'll just go.
With the April 26th editorial, the government took a firm stand against the student movement. The Communist Party has a tradition of passing judgment on social incidents through the media. In the past, Mao had written quite a few People's Daily editorials himself. He launched a number of mass political persecutions this way. That's why when the April 26th editorial came out, people assumed that it represented Deng's attitude toward the student demonstrations. Everyone expected that the government would crack down on any new demonstrations.
We were very angry. What petty minds. These people in the government have gone completely haywire. Just listen to what they're saying. It sounds like the Cultural Revolution all over again. The mindset, even the words, were identical to the editorial which came out after the Tianamen incident of 1976. We all lived through that episode. And we know how that ended up.
The editorial of April 26th reminded many people of what happened after another great state funeral, the events of 1976, known to everyone as the Tiananmen incident. In January of 1976, Premier Zhou Enlai, Mao's close associate, one of the great heroes of the revolution, died.
The people of the capital could not restrain their bitter grief. They left their homes and gathered on the sidewalks of the Chang'an Boulevard, along which the cortege would pass.
Zhou was widely regarded as a moderate, more humane and tolerant than other top leaders. Just as the mourning for Hu Yabong in 1989 was the occasion for protest, the outpouring of grief for Zhou Enlai was a reproach to the hardliners in power.
Can't you stop for a moment, dear Premier? This is Tiananmen. Don't you remember the many festive occasions we celebrated here together? Your ringing laughter is still in our ears. Your warm gaze rests on our tears. Beloved Premier Zhou, how we miss you, how we need you.
The times when important leaders die are dangerous. Zhou Enlai was a mentor of Deng Xiaoping. He helped bring Deng back into government to counter the excesses of the Cultural Revolution. Deng gave the eulogy at Zhou's funeral. But the events following Zhou's death would once again bring Deng Xiaoping down. That April, during the traditional festival in honor of the dead, thousands of people gathered spontaneously in Tiananmen Square to lay wreaths in honor of Zhou Enlai. They read poems, gave speeches. Reports made to Mao said the agitation was really directed against him. Police removed the wreaths, but people brought more. Police ordered the crowds to disperse. The crowds overturned a police van and set it afire. At last, Mao took action. Workers armed with clubs were sent in. There were beatings and arrests. In the official press, the events in the square were denounced as counter-revolutionary violence inspired by a small handful of conspirators. The alleged mastermind behind the turmoil was that unrepentant reactionary, Deng Xiaoping. Deng was denounced, condemned, forced from power. Not until after Mao's death would he emerge as China's new paramount leader. Then, the verdict on the 1976 upheavals would be reversed. The scenes in Tiananmen Square would be replayed with a different meaning. They became courageous demonstrations of the people's will. And yet now, in 1989, the government of Deng Xiaoping, faced again with protests inspired by the death of a leader, reached for the old words of denunciation. Once again, the supreme leader heard reports that the agitation was directed against him. Once again, a small handful of conspirators were supposedly plotting to bring down the state. Once again, the irrevocable judgment was passed.
The editorial of April 26th caught the students by total surprise. We didn't expect that the government would jump to such a vicious conclusion about us. We felt that without large-scale street action, we couldn't compete with the propaganda machine of the government, and the people wouldn't know the truth about what we were doing.
The Chinese constitution guarantees the people free speech and the right to demonstrate. But Chinese law punishes counter-revolutionary instigation by the enemies of the people. The final arbiter was the Communist Party. Were the students the people? Or were they now enemies of the people who must be suppressed?
I got together with some friends to talk about the situation. All of us were teachers at various universities. We heard that huge numbers of police would be deployed the next day. This really worried us. We decided to demonstrate with our students. We felt that we must show where we stood at a moment like this.
In the early morning of April 27th, students set out from campuses all over the city and walked toward Tiananmen Square, the political center of China. Police were placed on alert throughout Beijing and positioned to blockade key intersections along the route.
We were prepared to face great danger. Some students even wrote their wills. This was because we had heard that the government was moving in troops to suppress any further demonstrations. Everyone showed a lot of self-control. Since the government had accused us of instigating turmoil, we were eager to show the people that we weren't a lawless mob, nor were we trying to overthrow the Communist Party or socialism.
Many workers were furious. The government said that the students were instigating turmoil. Well, the way I see it, if the students were wrong, you wouldn't have to send the police or the soldiers. There are plenty of young workers like me who could beat them up. But the students were right. They expressed what was in the hearts of us workers. That's why we went out to support them.
I was really moved that day. The students held out cardboard boxes for donations, and I stuffed money in them. When I saw the students were sweating, I bought popsicles for them. I supported this demonstration because it was focused against one of the most fundamental means by which the Communist Party maintains its rule, that is, to accuse people of fabricated political crimes. The students showed real conviction. They put their lives and their future on the line to fight this unjust system. When we started out, I was very worried about the possibility of bloodshed. I kept telling the students that if we encountered the police, we should not force our way past them. At one point, the clash with the police was so intense that people could have been trampled to death. I was almost crushed in the crowd. But it was obvious that the police were not ordered to beat people up. They only tried to form a human blockade.
The students met little further resistance. They continued their march toward Tiananmen Square.
The students were very pleased with themselves for breaking through police lines, and the cheering of onlookers made them feel like real heroes. The whole thing now turned into a carnival, because there was no more danger, and everyone was watching the students' big show. That was how I felt later that day, completely different from when I started out.
It had been an unprecedented day. A mass student demonstration, held in the face of government warnings, had been allowed to march peacefully through the streets. And that very day, the government announced that it was willing to talk.
In this event, both sides had made efforts to exercise restraint. This unprecedented moment could have opened up new possibilities, if only people understood what he meant. But a historical opportunity is often easily overlooked, easily passed by. Unfortunately, this was just what happened.
I had just arrived back in China at that point. I suggested to the students that it was not a good idea to continue staging huge demonstrations. Once you have shown your strength, you should return to classes and try to secure some specific democratic rights on campus.
Few students were ready simply to go back to class. But what should they do next? The triumph of April 27th would be the last moment in which all parties working for change were united. The euphoria soon began to fade, and disagreements over tactics developed.
What a student movement represents is a call for social justice. There are times when we have no choice but to take to the streets to express our ideas, vent our anger, and show our determination to change things. April 27th was such a time. The students did a great job, and the government was forced to change its usual behavior. But our ultimate goal is to change the entire system. This cannot be accomplished by students staying in the streets.
The students demanded that the government grant legal status to their new organization, the Coalition of Independent Student Unions, and talk with them as equals. They wanted duihua, dialogue.
One of the most important demands raised by the students was for the government to have a dialogue with them. Where did the idea of dialogue come from? Actually, Zhao Ziyang was the first to promote it. He said government leaders should engage in dialogue with ordinary people. The party hardliners opposed this from the start. It's absurd, they said. The party and the people are one family. How can a family negotiate with itself? You're trying to imitate the West. They wouldn't even let us use the word duihua.
Duihua, dialogue, was a key part of the reformer strategy to open up the political system. It was aimed at making officials at all levels more responsive to popular opinion. The head of the party, General Secretary Zhao Ziyang, was a leading advocate of these reforms. At the 1987 Party Congress, Zhao was finally able to get the principle of dialogue adopted as official policy. But to have the entrenched party bureaucracy behave in new ways was another matter. On April 29th, the government held a meeting with representatives of the official student union of Beijing. Only a few of the new activists managed to get in. Yuan Mu was the government spokesman. His was not the new, more open-faced that Zhao Ziyang wanted. He spoke with the voice of standard party authoritarianism, and he did most of the talking. The independent student unions called this meeting a fraud. Surrounded by the media, the student leaders made the rounds of government offices to present their conditions for further talks. At one government bureau, a group from the countryside was trying to get their grievances heard. Grassroots democracy hadn't reached their village, so they were doing what they'd always done, kneeling before the offices of the central government to beg for official intervention in their local problems. They were having little luck getting anyone to listen. The student said that unless the government accepted their preconditions for dialogue, they would march again. Some student activists were trying to institute elections, and they were getting support on campus. Through elections on many campuses, a student dialogue group was formed. The students now changed their tactics. Rather than demanding official recognition as a precondition for dialogue, they were willing to talk right away. And they wanted to talk about their constitutional rights.
The aim of dialogue was not to solve everything at once. We wanted to establish some ground rules, open up some channels for communication, so that whenever problems arose, there'd be ways of resolving them. We wanted to lay some foundations for the future. We wanted to make a good start. What we were hoping for was gradual progress, reform, not cataclysmic change, not revolution. Because honestly, in 1989, the situation wasn't so bad that people felt they needed a revolution.
A new path seemed to be opening up, a path leading away from the confrontational politics that had dominated China for decades. The path China had long ago failed to take. On May 4th, China celebrated the 70th anniversary of the demonstrations of 1919, when patriotic students had first protested against an unresponsive government. There were two celebrations on that day, the government-sponsored commemorations at the monument and a mass student march from the university district to Tiananmen Square. Students sang a patriotic song from the 1930s. In official Communist Party history, the student protests of 1919 were but a prelude to the party's revolutionary makeover of China. But in fact, many of the leading voices of the May 4th era spoke not for revolution, but for democratic reform. After their days of street protest, many students went back to school, took up various professions, and continued to work for social change. Those who saw no hope for reform joined the Communist Party to fight for an ideal society. Over the decades, the voices championing gradual change were either stifled by conservative power holders or drowned out by cries for revolution. By marching into Tiananmen Square, the students of 1989 were saying to the party, "We are the true inheritors of the democratic legacy of the May 4th movement." But the May 4th spirit they were most familiar with was the one the party had taught them.
In the value system of the Communist Party, revolution is placed at the top. So comrades are called revolutionary comrades, couples revolutionary couples, and families revolutionary families. Everything is revolutionary. Reform is not a good word in communist vocabulary. What we were trying to do was to introduce the idea of incremental change to the people of China. We were trying to tell them that reform was not a bad thing, and that revolution often failed to deliver its promise.
Once again, the government had not suppressed the march. In fact, the leaders at the top were deeply divided on how to deal with the protesters. On the very day of the May 4th anniversary, Party Secretary General Zhao Ziyang made a speech that departed surprisingly from the hardline April 26 editorial. In a nationally televised meeting with foreign bankers, Zhao told his audience that there was no serious turmoil in China. Duai Hua, dialogue, Zhao said, was the solution to the present tension. The students now debated, should they go back to class and show support for this conciliatory attitude? Or did Zhao Ziyang's remarks indicate deep rifts in the central government that must be exploited by pushing harder, going farther? Many students went back to class.
On May 8th,
Several leaders of the Independent Student Union of my university came to see me. They complained about the students who had returned to class and said they wanted to blockade the classrooms. I said, I thought you were demanding democracy. A basic principle of democracy is the right of individual choice. If you deprive others of their choice, how is that different from the way the Communist Party has always deprived you of your choice? It had not even occurred to them that this was a problem. They couldn't come up with any good arguments in response, but they still felt uncomfortable. They said, then how can we get anything done? In China, everything has always been handled this way. Only by preventing others from doing what they want can you accomplish what you want. The movement at Beijing University also reached a low point. More and more students returned to class. A lot of energy was wasted debating whether we should go back to class or not. I felt increasingly frustrated.
At that time, I thought we should resume classes because I felt a stalemate like this wouldn't necessarily get us anywhere, and the students were pretty tired.
On May 10th, Wang Dan gave an interview to a Canadian television reporter.
I think that the student movement should move on to a new stage. No more large-scale, intense street action. No more boycotting classes. Instead, we need down-to-earth work to build democracy on campus. The legalization of student organizations, independent student newspapers and radio stations, and so on. This work might not look all that grand or glamorous, but it's extremely important.
And yet, over the heads of the prominent student leaders still hung the People's Daily editorial of April 26th, the shadow of Deng Luan. That threat cut off any impulse toward moderation.
Once we were chatting, I said, how many years do political offenders get? Someone said it used to be 3 years, then it was increased to 5 years, then 7, and then 17 years. I felt very sad. If I got 17 years, I'd be 40 by the time I got out. I really didn't want that to happen.
On May 11th, six of us discussed the situation. We had placed a lot of hope on talks with the government, but they kept putting it off. We feared that the movement would run out of momentum. Then the government would have been able to arrest the student leaders one by one and disband the independent unions. So it was necessary to escalate the movement, to use more radical methods and apply more pressure to force the government to concede to our demands. Since demonstrations and sit-down strikes no longer bothered the government, we felt the next step should be a hunger strike.
Wang Dan told me about the hunger strike, and I immediately signed on. Then we tried to persuade the leaders of the independent student unions, but some of them were firmly opposed to a hunger strike. I think they have a tendency towards opportunism.
As is so often the case, democratic procedures were getting in the way of political action. Unable to achieve a consensus within the independent student unions, the people in favor of a hunger strike bypassed the new organization and made personal appeals to the students.
On the evening of May 12th, Chai Ling and I addressed the students. She did most of the talking. She said that the government was forcing us to put our lives on the line. She was crying emotionally. This got everyone really stirred up.
I said, we are staging a hunger strike in order to reveal the true face of the government and the true face of the people. We want to see whether the Chinese have any conscience, whether there is any hope for China. I said, we are prepared to face death for the sake of true life. The oath written by our lives will brighten the skies of our country.
At noon on May 13th, the hunger strikers shared a last ceremonial meal.
The strikers wanted the government to repeal the April 26th editorial and hold televised talks with the students. That morning, the government had met one of these demands. They'd agreed to talks with the dialogue group. But by the time this news reached the universities, the hunger strikers had already set out for Tiananmen Square. Their declaration, born of a tradition of romantic communist rhetoric, was both heroic and deeply emotional. It even included some lines from Mao's youth. This country is our country, this people our people. If we don't speak out, who will? If we don't take action, who will? At the height of youthful happiness and beauty, the hunger strikers proclaimed, we must resolutely leave everything behind us. Mother China, witness now the actions of your sons and daughters. Can you remain indifferent as hunger devours our youth and death approaches?
昨天晚上3点到凌晨之间这一段，同学们又冷又饿，但同学们挺过来了。还有可能我们还要挺过像昨天这样的第三个、第五个夜晚。希望大家能够尽可能的坚持到底。有没有决心？有！谢谢大家，真是好战友。
The hunger strike could not have come at a worse time for the government. That week, a historic meeting, years in preparation, was to take place. The president of the Soviet Union, Mikhail Gorbachev, was coming to China. A grand welcoming ceremony was scheduled to take place in Tiananmen Square, which was filled at the moment with thousands of students.
On May 15th, the government planned to welcome Gorbachev at Tiananmen Square. Everyone knew that the square would have to be cleared. So the students thought that if they staged the hunger strike there, the government would definitely respond by May 15th. I heard many students talk like this.
On the afternoon of May 14th, less than 24 hours before Gorbachev's arrival, the government began talks with the dialogue group. The main official representative was Yan Mingfu, a leading reformist minister. Some students who had initiated the hunger strike were also present. Wu Kaixi was one of them.
The biggest victory of the whole movement was that our hunger strike forced the government to the negotiating table. We demanded a live television broadcast, but the government agreed only to a pre-recorded broadcast. So we made a concession on this point. We felt that a pre-recorded broadcast was in itself a hard-won achievement.
But the hunger strikers who were waiting at the square did not hear the promised broadcast. Feeling betrayed, many of them rushed to the meeting hall and disrupted the session.
So the talks were wrecked by the students themselves. I felt that May 14th was a big setback for the student movement. After this, the students missed many more opportunities by repeating the same mistakes.
It was the eve of Gorbachev's arrival, and talks between the students and the government had broken down.
When we speak of the government, we're talking about two kinds of people: the reformers who were in power at the time, and the hardliners who opposed them. Reform was in a very precarious situation and came under constant attack. The reformers hoped for social stability so that they could continue their difficult work. The hardliners had been using all kinds of underhanded tactics to get Deng Xiaoping to turn against the reformers. But they hadn't seen much success. So they wanted to create a massive crisis in order to get rid of the reformers, as they had Hu Yaobang. I was worried that reform would be derailed. If that happened, then all the grand sloganizing about democracy, about abolishing dictatorship, and so on, would simply be a lot of hot air.
The 12 scholars, journalists, and critics were well-known supporters of liberal reform in China and widely respected. They all praised the students, but called on them to change their tactics.
The problem with these intellectuals was that they were playing the wrong role. They were acting as mediators between the students and the government. We made the government agree to face-to-face negotiations. This was the first time in 40 years, and we accomplished it. We, the students, acting as an independent political force. And then, when we invited the intellectuals to join us, they came to the square and addressed us as children. The message we got from them was this: you people have gone too far. You have to do this gradually. Listen to your mommy and daddy. Listen to your government. Well, all I have to say is, what have you done that gives you the right to criticize us?
The 12 scholars had made an accurate assessment of the situation, and they were well-intentioned. They knew this stalemate would harm the students' cause, but all the students had put so much into the hunger strike, how could the government simply ignore us? If we left, it would have been like encouraging a bully. Emotionally, we couldn't accept that. You can tell me all you want about what a rational person should do, but I say, excuse me, I can't be that rational because I'm not facing a rational opponent.
We failed completely. At the time, I felt we intellectuals were caught between a totally irrational government and totally irrational students. What could we do?
Although most students were unimpressed by the intellectuals' attempt at mediation, some shared their belief that Gorbachev's visit would help the cause of reform in China. As a last-minute compromise, Wu Kai-shi led the call to make room for the official welcoming ceremony for the Soviet leader.
We really weren't willing. We decided not to move because, well, I'll quote the words of a foreign reporter. He said, "You are already on a hunger strike. What more can they ask of you?" On the night of the 14th, everybody was waiting for the clearing of the square. Everyone was restless. Why aren't they coming? Why aren't they coming? On the morning of the 15th, I phoned a friend. We both felt that the situation was very grim. If the government ignored the students on May 15th, they would be put in a very awkward position. What were they going to do? Stay on a hunger strike forever?
If the government can simply stand by and watch while the students' lives slowly waste away like this, we will have to take even more drastic measures. We will set ourselves on fire. If the government is callous enough to see these children starve to death, then I will be the first to die. I said this over the loudspeakers. I said I was willing to be the commander-in-chief. I don't remember my exact words. I said the only criterion for a person to join the hunger strike leadership was a willingness to be the first to die, so that other students could live on.
The government chose to cancel the grand ceremony planned for Tiananmen Square. Gorbachev got only a quick welcome at the airport. The first visit to China by a Soviet head of state since 1959 had been upstaged by the students. Gorbachev met with party leaders like Zhao Ziyang, who looked to the Soviet Union as an example of political reform, and with others, like Premier Li Peng, who were wary of everything Gorbachev represented. Both groups in the Chinese government needed the backing of Deng Xiaoping, who was in charge of the military, and thus held the real reins of power. By now, the hunger strikers had been in the square for 2 days, and their numbers were increasing constantly. Still, there was no official response. As time dragged on, sympathy for the students and anger at the government grew.
I couldn't even convince my own students to leave. The female students cried whenever I spoke to them. In the morning sun, the students looked so young, with only sheets of newspapers between themselves and the bare ground. It was really a touching sight. They were putting their young lives on the line, sitting there stubbornly. But the government was ignoring them. I was moved. So I decided to stay on the square to help them run errands.
We workers and ordinary people had been looking on. Then, when the students started the hunger strike, using their own lives to awaken the whole nation, people felt their responsibilities and they rose up too.
On May 16th, while Gorbachev continued his discussions with the Chinese leadership, 300,000 people marched in the streets of Beijing. On the 17th, and again on the 18th, that number rose to 1 million people.
I went to the square every day after May 15th because a lot of students from my university were taking part in the hunger strike. I went there to help them with logistics and run errands. I also took part in the picket line to ensure that the ambulances could move freely.
The students had been on a hunger strike for nearly a week. And still, the government paid no attention to them. We said, what bastards? Any son of a bitch would have acted better than Deng Xiaoping or Li Peng.
Moderate government leaders tried to defuse the mountain crisis. The official media was allowed to report sympathetically on the hunger strike. Emergency medical teams were sent in to ensure the health of the hunger strikers. Actions like these suggested that the party line was shifting and nobody wanted to be left on the wrong side. Local party leaders and managers started permitting their workers to go to Tiananmen to show support for the students. Organized contingents started showing up carrying the banners of their workplaces. To participate now was beginning to look not only right, but safe. The spectacle was overwhelming and highly photogenic. The foreign press in Beijing to cover the Sino-Soviet summit walked into the biggest international media story ever reported out of China.
What a place, what a time, what a story. It's Friday morning here, and this is Tiananmen Square. Today, it's the People's Square, all right. More than a million Chinese demanding democracy and freedom and proclaiming the new revolution.
Unbelievable. We all came here to cover a summit and we walked into a revolution.
It's a great feeling to get the attention of tens of thousands of people. Before the movement, the students had been very depressed. All of a sudden, they were at center stage. People needed them. They felt a heroic sense of being able to change history. This feeling was a boost to their egos and whet their appetites for more.
There's never been a generation like ours, one that mocked the state, mocked the government, mocked the leaders. And there's never been a generation that has seen that the outside world is so beautiful. Sui Jian is China's most famous singer. His song, Nothing to My Name, expresses our feelings. Does our generation have anything? We don't have the goals our parents had. We don't have the fanatical idealism our older brothers and sisters once had. So what do we want? Nike shoes. Lots of free time to take our girlfriends to a bar. The freedom to discuss an issue with someone. And to get a little respect from society.
In this process, there was something so pure, so unforgettable. There were also things I couldn't accept, even things I found repulsive. But they were all mixed together, and this is history. History is this kind of process. There's no way to sort things out neatly. For example, during the hunger strike, some students were actually eating. They felt that the hunger strike was only a means to an end. Our aim is to put pressure on the government, so why should we make real sacrifices? One student was outraged. You people are manipulating the public. He said, once you turn your sacrifice into a hoax, you lose your moral integrity. So he wrote in blood, I want to use my blood to defend the purity of the hunger strike. I was very moved. This kind of gesture might not have any significant political impact, but to me, it showed a deep sense of decency, something that had become very rare in China.
During the days of mounting protest, reformist officials faced an impossible predicament. They didn't have the power to make the concessions the students demanded, yet they knew if they couldn't get the students to leave the square, hardliners were more than willing to use force. And the army had already been mobilized. Furthermore, since the breakdown of the May 14 talks, it was no longer clear who really represented the students. The only way to communicate with the protesters was to appeal directly to the crowds in the square. On May 16th, accompanied by student leader Wang Dan, the reformist official Yan Mingfu made such an attempt.
He was on the verge of tears. He asked the students to give the party reformers more time. He even went out on a limb to tell us that the problem of the April 26th editorial would definitely be solved, but it would take time. He was very sincere. He said that the Central Committee had guaranteed the student activists wouldn't be persecuted. He said, "If you don't believe me, you can take me hostage." Then I said, "I hope everyone will consider this proposal carefully." But the atmosphere was so highly emotional, it was impossible for either of us to continue. So Yan Mingfu left.
Only hours after Yan Mingfu's appearance in the square, a letter from Zhao Ziyang, written on behalf of the Central Committee, was broadcast. In essence, it contradicted the April 26th editorial. But the strike continued. The following day, Premier Li Peng summoned a group of student leaders to the Great Hall of the People for a televised meeting. Some hunger strikers came straight from their hospital beds.
我认为我没有必要再把我一开始说过的话再重复一遍，但是好像有些领导同志还没有明白，那么我愿意再重复一遍。现在解决问题的关键并不是说服我们在座的这些人，问题在于怎么去让他们离开，他们离开的条件我已经说得很清楚了，刚才他们离开这里的条件我已经说得很清楚了，只有这一种可能性，这是客观现实，客观事实，我们如果广场上有一个人不离开，还在继续绝食的话，我们就很难保证剩下的几千人不离开。
In the pre-dawn hours of May 19th, a worn and haggard Zhao Ziyang appeared suddenly on Tiananmen Square. Zhao had lost out to the hardliners in the party. On the verge of tears, he said to the students, "We have come too late. We deserve your criticism." Zhao then disappeared from public view.
When the reformers were still in power, that is to say, before Zhao Ziyang was removed, he was the most powerful person next to Deng Xiaoping. The students didn't accept any of Zhao Ziyang's compromises. They didn't want to cooperate with him in any way. Once he was defeated, it was the hardliners' turn to show how they deal with things.
The government was now ready to declare martial law. This news was leaked to the hunger strike headquarters ahead of time. The students suddenly announced the end of their week-long hunger strike and began a mass sit-in. On the evening of May 19th, Premier Li Peng addressed an emergency meeting of state and army leaders. His speech was broadcast as army units moved toward the city. Li Peng's speech only served to incite the people of Beijing. Street merchants got on their motorcycles. Calling themselves the Flying Tigers, they sped to the square to report on troop movements.
convoys were blocked by crowds of protesters and their supporters. The People's Liberation Army had entered Beijing once before, in 1949. It was a time when the PLA was welcomed in many cities. Over the years, the army was seen as a true people's army, from the people, of the people, and for the people. The party said that the army was like fish and the people like water. Fish can't live out of water. The PLA was the guardian of the state, protector of the people. In times of natural disaster, the army was there to help fight floods, famine, and fire. Party propaganda promoted a popular image of the army. Films, fiction, and stage productions celebrated the PLA and created a pantheon of army heroes for mass consumption. In early 1989, the PLA received its annual tribute in the Chinese New Year TV extravaganza. Now, 40 years after being welcomed into Beijing, the army was coming again. This time, it came as an alien force. On the morning of May 20th, martial law regulations were announced. The police and the army were authorized to clear the streets. But people ignored the government's orders. The city was still jammed with demonstrators. Helicopters were the only military vehicles moving. Faced with the threat of armed repression, the students tried to mobilize even greater public support.
大家都有的口号一起起步，通通下台。
Just at the moment when the students most needed the support and protection of a mass movement, a group of workers declared the founding of an independent union. They set up a public address station at the northwest corner of Tiananmen Square.
I became a broadcaster. People sent us a lot of letters. For the last 40 years, there had been no channel for them to express themselves. By broadcasting their letters, we gave them a voice. There are many people like me. We wanted to listen to something simple, direct, and to the point.
The Independent Workers Union not only put forth our own demands, it also helped out the students by sending them food and water. Without the people of Beijing, the workers, the farmers from the outskirts of the city, and the street merchants, the students could not have persisted for long.
The new union helped mobilize citizens to block the martial law troops. For some 48 hours, the troops remained stuck in the sea of the people, moving neither forward nor back.
I saw an old woman lying down in front of a military truck. Her face was all wrinkles and she had no front teeth. I saw all these ordinary people acting not out of political calculation or with any ulterior motive, but purely out of sympathy and a sense of justice, confronting the troops to protect the students on Tiananmen Square. I was very moved. Sometimes I was disappointed in how foolish and childish the students could be. Once a couple of them came to me to discuss their plans. One claimed to be the commander-in-chief of student security guards. Tourist map in hand, he began to command. He said, "See here, to the south of us there are such and such troops, and to the north of us there are such and such troops." He had all 4 points of the compass covered. I was reminded of a movie I saw called From Victory to Victory. In it, the communist commander points to a map and says, "Facing us are this many troops, on our flank are that many troops, and so on." I watched this kid carrying on like this and felt like laughing. He said, "If we blockaded every intersection, we'd be spreading our troops too thin. I plan to concentrate our forces closer to the square." I felt that this manner of military command, like a child playing at war, came straight out of communist propaganda. And I wondered, how did I get involved with this lot?
The massive show of resistance to the army was successful. The troops pulled back to the suburbs. The danger had passed. People continued to pour into the streets. The workers had helped win a victory for the movement at the square. But unlike the students, their need to make a living tied them to their workplaces.
A union unrelated to the workplace is not really a union at all. Yet here we were, setting up a union at Tiananmen Square, inspired by a student movement. What kind of future could it possibly have? But there was no way we could organize in the factories. Furthermore, I knew that the movement was going to come to an end soon. All we could do was to try to take advantage of the popular fervor to educate the workers, to let them know that the Constitution grants them all kinds of rights, none of which have been put into practice. This way, after the movement in the streets ended and things returned to normal, some effects of the movement would still be felt. What I mean here is an awareness of constitutional rights. Workers and peasants would know what rights they should enjoy. They'd also know about the legal channels open to them so they can demand those rights.
Meanwhile, among the students, a struggle over tactics unfolded.
Some of us wanted the students to leave the square. Not only out of consideration for the students' safety, we also thought it was good tactics. By leaving the square, we would have undermined the rationale for imposing martial law, and that might have given the reformers in the government an opportunity.
Many students do not understand that the square is our only stronghold. Some people have repeatedly advocated that we leave, but that could only please the government. What makes me really sad is that I am the commander-in-chief, and I can't let go of this power because I must resist compromise, resist these traitors. The leaders of the independent student unions of Beijing and of the provinces are all after my power.
In the intense atmosphere of the square, the leaders with more radical agendas had the advantage. These were people who had come to prominence through the hunger strike. They had not stood for elections on campus. Their credentials were a determination to make the greatest sacrifices. Their power base, the continuing acclaim of their followers. They set up a new headquarters to defend Tiananmen Square. Once more, Chai Ling became commander-in-chief. The commander had control of the loudspeakers, the voice of the square that broadcast to the masses. The continued hard line pursued by the government would further undermine moderation and encourage a hard line among the students.
I used to believe that we could establish democratic processes and then a lot of people could use science to really help our country. But now I've come to realize that unless we overthrow this inhuman government, our country will have no hope. Our people will have no hope. After people prevented the army convoys from entering the city, there was a stalemate. During this lull, people were at a loss and didn't know what to do next. This happened over and over again during the movement. Following each new escalation, people fell into a state of confusion. No one knew what to do or what to expect. So students simply hung around the square waiting. At night, music drifted from different parts of the square. Once, I was awakened after midnight by a rowdy concert. People were shouting and laughing, making a huge ruckus.
Popular music, of course, came from the West. When young people try to express themselves, to sing about their own concerns, it's really a form of liberalization. That's why this music was such an important part of the movement. When someone takes part in a rock concert, that kind of crazy feeling is all about self-liberation and about self-expression.
The new music came via Hong Kong and Taiwan. One of the most famous Taiwan singers was Ho Dejian. Ho moved to the mainland in 1983 in search of his roots. He was the first pop star to appear on national television.
Hello.
Our culture, as well as the political system in mainland China, suppresses the individual and promotes the collective. Collectivism and patriotism are used to make the majority serve the few. The message is, you are not allowed to care about yourself. Any concern about personal interest simply means that you are selfish. I call the 1989 movement a self-liberation movement. I don't like calling the founding of the People's Republic of China in 1949 liberation. Did Mao really liberate the Chinese people? Gradually people realized, we're not really liberated. We want to liberate ourselves. But Mao didn't want that. Later, Deng Xiaoping didn't want that either. During the movement, everyone wanted to release their pent-up anger and frustration. How come you can liberate me, but I can't liberate myself?
Many people in Beijing felt it in those days of protest, the sense of being lifted out of their daily drudgery by a cause greater than themselves. Maybe now, through real democracy, a perfect society was possible. There was a heightened sense of community, of giving, of shared sacrifice. It was said that even the thieves had gone on strike for the common good. In the vast square, in this space designed to make the many feel as one, a space dedicated to the manufacturing of public life, the personal gesture now became significant, each small act of generosity seeming to prophesy a new way of living together, a new civility. It was a feeling as intense as it was transitory.
I watched the student movement on TV. It was exciting to see so many people demanding democracy. But I was worried by the general intangible nature of their demands. In China, all information is so tightly controlled by the Communist Party that people whose lives are run by this huge machine have no idea how it really works. So they usually behave in one of two ways. They either accept party rule passively, or summon the courage to try and smash it all to pieces. But what happens after it's been smashed?
Faced with a territory and a population to govern, the student leaders on the square found themselves recreating in miniature all the real-life problems of having and holding power. External threats of government repression meant enforcing internal security. Disagreements with the leadership were labeled betrayal, sabotage, by the familiar small handful of plotters. Struggles between the groups vying for power in the square grew increasingly ugly.
As commanders, we tried to make our decision-making process as open as possible. But many students still felt that they had no normal channels through which to express their opinions. When they wanted to be heard, they'd try to seize power. Some student guard units were formed in a bizarre way. Someone from the square would run to the train station to meet newcomers from the provinces. He'd announce, "I am the commander of the student security guards. Come with me. The square needs you."
So the newcomers, who had no idea what was going on, would become the guy's guard. Then they'd surround the student headquarters or the broadcast station and drive away our guards. Once they took control of the broadcast station, they were in power. Often we had to suppress three or four coups a day. At the time I even joked. Now I finally understand why Li Peng wanted to suppress the students.
Once I made a suggestion to the students, that was around May 23rd. I said, why not hold an election at the square or on your campuses? One student, one vote, and elect leaders of the student union. But they thought elections were unthinkable in the middle of all that chaos. Then a week later, I heard that the students were setting up a democracy university in the square. I thought, well, that suggestion of mine was at the level of a democracy kindergarten. You people didn't like it. So now you're setting up a democracy university. But no matter what, you still have to vote.
By the end of May, the students' resources, financial, political, and emotional, were running low. And the square was getting more squalid every day. Some concerned intellectuals had set up joint meetings involving workers and citizens groups, the independent student unions, and the Defend Tiananmen Square headquarters. They had been meeting regularly since May 23rd. Wang Dan acted as liaison among them.
At a meeting on May 27th, Chai Ling and Feng Chengde reported on the situation in the square. The impression we got was that things were really chaotic. There was endless factional infighting, and sanitary conditions were terrible. We began to doubt whether anything positive could come out of this ongoing stalemate. So we drafted a proposal. The vote in favor of it was unanimous, including Chai Ling. Later, we held a press conference in the square to announce this proposal. After the press conference, Li Lu raised objections to our proposal. Then Chai Ling changed her mind and decided to oppose it too.
The people who made the decision to leave the square on May 30th had a very negative effect on the movement. I attended the meeting, but I didn't realize at the time how harmful the decision would be. The real issue at the meeting was that some people were trying to use the movement to make themselves famous, and we opposed this. I want to say to everyone that the square is our only stronghold. If we lose it, the conservatives will overrun China.
I regret we didn't debate the issue further. Although we had many good arguments in our favor, we felt we couldn't compete with the emotional appeal of their position. So we gave up. I think we should have acted more responsibly. After that, I thought that any attempt to influence the situation on the square would be futile. There was nothing more I could do. So I decided to go back to campus and do what I could to further democracy there.
Why did the students want to stay at Tiananmen? Because our goal was to awaken the people. Tiananmen is the symbol of our People's Republic. When we took action there, we were telling people throughout the country that there were still some of us who dared to fight back. A lot of students felt that the longer we held out, the more time people would have to think freely. We held a meeting at the square every night. 200 to 300 representatives from the various universities would get together. The issue of whether or not to leave came up almost every time. At least 80% of the students always voted to stay. If we were to stick to the principle of majority rule, it was impossible to leave the square.
The student population at the square was constantly changing. As those who grew discouraged or disgusted left, they were replaced by enthusiastic newcomers from all over the country. At any one time, there was a majority on the square who would vote to stay. Those who thought it best to leave voted with their feet. As the students debated whether or not to continue their occupation of the square, a marathon benefit concert was being held on a racetrack in Hong Kong. Millions of dollars were raised for the movement in Beijing. That night, a shipment of tents and other supplies arrived at the square, the first installment in a flood of support from Hong Kong. Successfully resisted the proposal to move the struggle back to the campuses and allied herself once more with those determined to hold the square. On the following morning, she contacted American journalist Philip Cunningham.
I have been feeling very sad recently. The students themselves lack a developed sense of democracy. To be honest, from the day I called for a hunger strike, I knew we would not get any results. Certain people, certain causes are bound to fail. I have been very clear about this all along, but I've made an effort to present a staunch image, to show that we were striving for victory. But deep down, I knew it was all futile. The more involved I got, the sadder I became. I already felt this back in April. All along, I've kept it to myself, because being Chinese, I felt I shouldn't badmouth the Chinese. But I can't help thinking sometimes, and I might as well say it. You, the Chinese, you are not worth my struggle. You are not worth my sacrifice. But then, I can also see that in this movement, there are many people who do have a conscience. There are many decent people among the students, workers, citizens, and intellectuals. The students keep asking, what should we do next? What can we accomplish? I feel so sad. Because how can I tell them that what we are actually hoping for is bloodshed? For the moment when the government has no choice but to brazenly butcher the people. Only when the square is awash with blood will the people of China open their eyes. Only then will they really be united. But how can I explain any of this to my fellow students? And what is truly sad is that some students and some famous, well-connected people are working hard to help the government, to prevent it from taking such measures. For the sake of their selfish interests and their private dealings, they are trying to cause our movement to collapse and get us out of the square before the government becomes so desperate that it takes action. If we allow the movement to collapse on its own, then the government will be able to wipe out all the leaders of the movement, as well as those leaders in the party and in the military who dare to oppose them, who represent the people. Deng Xiaoping has made it very clear that there is a small handful of people, not only in the party and in society, but also among the students. That's why I feel so sad, because I can't say all this to my fellow students. I can't tell them straight out that we must use our blood and our lives to call on the people to rise up. Of course, the students will be willing, but they are still such young children.
Are you going to stay in the square yourself?
No, I won't.
Why?
Because my situation is different. My name is on the government's hit list. I'm not going to let myself be destroyed by this government. I want to live. Anyway, that's how I feel about it. I don't know if people will say I'm selfish. I believe that others have to continue the work I have started. A democracy movement can't succeed with only one person.
When Chai Ling finished her interview, she asked the American journalist to take the tape he had made out to the world. She told him she must now leave Beijing and go underground. That day, students at the nearby Central Art Academy were finishing work on a statue which they called the Goddess of Democracy. The next night, as the Goddess of Democracy moved from the Art Academy to Tiananmen, a television reporter interviewed Chai Ling in one of the new tents on the square. She had changed her mind about leaving. Democracy, the ideal everyone talked about. She stood facing Mao Zedong on the Gate of Heavenly Peace. Mao, who had said that he too wanted democracy, mass democracy. What does democracy mean? What was it coming to mean in China? What could it be made to mean? If democracy came to China, what would she look like? Whose features would she wear? There seemed a chance, at least, that her face would look all too familiar.
Although some cracks have appeared in the system over the past 10 years, the way the whole nation thinks has not yet broken free of the mold created by Mao. In the past century or so, the Chinese people have shed blood time and again without losing the courage to fight for their ideals. Each battle, however, has ended in a new tragedy, another shattered dream. I believe that what the Chinese lack is not ideals, but the means through which to realize them. Not courage, but the wisdom necessary to achieve their goal. What the Chinese lack is not a heart, but a mind. During the Cultural Revolution, there was only one mind, that of Mao. After Mao's death, hundreds of millions of minds needed to start functioning again. It is much harder for the mind to recover than the stomach.
Though they gave the movement no new goals or direction, the bright new tents and supplies from Hong Kong, which included massive infusions of cash, would have lifted anyone's flagging spirits.
And
how did you raise the money in Hong Kong?
Several, many, many ways. For example, there was one concert for the democracy in China. In that concert alone, 14 million Hong Kong dollars, 14, was raised, okay? And through other channels, phone in, or I mean, many, many channels, through the Federation of Student Union in Hong Kong, they raised more than 10 million. So we are talking about quite some money here.
International support suggested the possibility of a real victory for the movement, but money did nothing to stop the struggles for power being played out on the square.
Holding
onto the square like this was absolutely meaningless, and I felt it was harmful to the students' cause. One day, a friend of mine, who was a fairly well-known intellectual, came to see me. I told him that I had been going to the square every day to persuade all of my students to leave. But he said the students should not leave. He said, with the students at the front lines, we'll be safe. Once the students withdraw, the government will come after the intellectuals. I was furious. I said, so you want the students to shield you from danger? What right do you have to hide behind them? Why don't you try living in the square like that? It's easy for you to talk, never missing a meal and sleeping in your own comfortable home.
After the May 27th decision to leave was overturned by people like Chai Ling, the students were in a predicament. They couldn't leave, yet by simply hanging on, the movement was losing its appeal, and the number of people coming to the square was dwindling. In our joint meetings, the discussions focused on how to straighten things out in the square. The students should either take the initiative to leave or stay on but improve their image. They couldn't afford just to sit there passively. But none of us could come up with anything practical. So I thought, I might as well go on a hunger strike.
Liu Xiaobo told me, if we don't join the students in the square and face the same kind of danger, then we don't have any right to speak.
On June 2nd, Liu Xiaobo and three of his friends set up a tent on the Martyrs' Monument and began their hunger strike.
There's no way for me to know whether our hunger strike had affected the government's decision to launch the bloody crackdown. If it did, I would feel guilty for the rest of my life. From the moment I walked out of the square, my heart has been heavy. After all that bloodshed on June 4th, I've never gotten over this.
The four men saw their hunger strike as a chance, maybe the last chance, to persuade the students to live up to their democratic goals and make their own decisions rather than reacting to escalating government threats.
We were making a plea to both the government and the students to abandon the ideology of class struggle, to abandon hostile attitudes, and act with greater tolerance. Everyone needed to examine their own behavior. Our hunger strike was not a heroic act, but a gesture of repentance for years of cowardice by Chinese intellectuals.
We felt that under no circumstances should people involved in this movement act in secrecy or use underhanded tactics. That's what our fathers and grandfathers have been doing all along. If you act like the people you oppose, you'll end up just like them. And then you'll have to be overthrown. So what's the point? Why start a movement in the first place?
The hunger strikers' gesture of humility and restraint had the paradoxical effect of revitalizing the flagging protest. Once again, the square filled with thousands of people. Ho Dejian's anthem, Children of the Dragon, was the best-selling pop song ever marketed in China. Everyone knew the words.
I never thought our hunger strike would have such an impact. Once again, the square was filled with people. But they hadn't necessarily been attracted by the ideas expressed in our declaration. I think the majority of them came because we had gone on a hunger strike. And especially because the famous rock star, Ho Dejian, was involved. There was Ho Dejian wearing his Songs for Democracy t-shirt. He was a real pro in the way he worked the crowd. He'd call out, "Do you know the singer, Deng Lijun?" "Yes," came the reply. Then Ho would look for the pop star's signature on his t-shirt. "Here she is, she's right here." The crowd went wild.
The four hunger strikers were soon infected themselves by the intense emotions on Tiananmen Square, the very thing they wanted to temper.
During the movement, I was so often divided. In our hunger strike declaration, I wrote about getting rid of hatred in politics and so on. But when I faced that cheering crowd and felt that we might actually defeat martial law, the voice of reason left me. Once you get involved in the actual situation, it was just so hard to keep a cool head, to know who the hell you are. Facing the thousands of people who cheered me on, I was completely carried away. Now here I was, speaking at Tiananmen Square, I felt that my words could sway the fate of the nation.
In the early hours of June 3rd, army units once again attempted to get to the square. Most of the troops weren't in combat gear, but people were outraged to find that some were actually armed. Protesters confiscated guns, cattle prods, cleavers, and knives, and displayed them as proof that the government intended to use violence. Then they turned the weapons over to the city police. When day came, crowds had stopped buses being used to transport weapons into the city and were ejecting the soldiers. Troops stationed in the nearby Great Hall of the People were ordered out to retake the buses. They too were surrounded and stopped. So the soldiers sat down, and everyone started to sing. Soldiers and protesters, each hoping, perhaps, to sing the other side into submission. They all sang the same few familiar songs from the days of the revolution. They sang, "Without the Communist Party, there is no new China," the PLA anthem, and the three disciplines and 8 points of attention. At the fringes of the singing match, nervous soldiers collided with excited citizens. Those hurt rushed to the square to tell their stories. At day's end, the troops from the Great Hall of the People were ordered back into the building. But though the army was apparently retreating once more, a decision had been made for a full-scale military assault. On the evening of June 3rd, troops and armored personnel carriers began converging on the center of the city. Far from the square on Chang'an Avenue, the Avenue of Eternal Peace, the great east-west thoroughfare, troops encountered crowds at every intersection. This time, they would not be stopped. Even after the soldiers opened fire, many people couldn't believe they were using live ammunition. The crowds blocking the intersections didn't always disperse when fired on, or they ran away but came back to yell at the troops. The sound of gunfire attracted even larger crowds.
We heard over the student loudspeakers that there was a state of emergency in Tiananmen. They called on people to go and show their support. He wanted to go at once, but I wouldn't let him. I said, "You're just a high school student. What difference can you make?" As I watched the government warnings on TV, I became very scared, but it just made him want to go all the more. I tried to hold him back, but he was so much taller and stronger than me. I couldn't stop him.
All along Chang'an Avenue, troops encountered barricades and crowds throwing rocks and Molotov cocktails. After an intersection was cleared, troops moved more quickly. A young woman with a home video camera recorded the troops passing Fuxingmen intersection about 2 miles west of the square.
At that time, all was still quiet at the monument. Horta Jen said that it was like being in the eye of the storm. A hurricane raged all around. Where we were, by our hunger strike tent, things were relatively calm.
This song is called The Beautiful Chinese. The students and the people of Beijing have done amazing things this past month. They've presented a beautiful image of the Chinese to the rest of the world.
爱自由的人们，张开我们的翅膀，有良心的人们，敞开我们的胸膛。The government's intentions are now clear. There's nothing more to be said. The important thing right now is our unity and the improvement of our own organizations. In the past, I have debated with a lot of people in my writings. I hope that in a moment like this, we can put all our differences behind us. Who will decide the fate of China? The answer is, the people will prevail.
Around 11 o'clock, 2 hours before the main body of the troops arrived, a single armored personnel carrier drove into the square.
Workers in Beijing residents stopped it. Someone hit it with a Molotov cocktail and it caught fire. The fire hardly slowed it down. Frankly, I was scared and got out of its way. Everyone got out of its way.
The official loudspeakers around the square suddenly came on and announced the emergency orders of the martial law troops. They said that the government was determined to suppress the counter-revolutionary violent rioting at all costs. The huge square, which had been filled with so many people, suddenly was emptying before my eyes. Only those of us on the monument remained. It really was eerie.
That night, I was at a friend's house. She came home around 11 o'clock and said the soldiers had opened fire at Muxidi intersection and tanks were moving through the streets. I knew some of my students were still in the square. I had to go there. I arrived at the square around midnight and found all 12 of my students. I decided to stay with them and do whatever I could to help prevent bloodshed.
Pushing the crowds before them, the troops now reach the stretch of Chang'an Avenue that lies between Tiananmen Gate and the square.
We wanted to see what was happening, so we headed south and ran smack into some soldiers. They weren't shooting into the sky or at the ground. They were shooting straight at us. Five workers beside me fell. At first we said, "Come on, guys, stop fooling around and get up." But then we saw the blood. Some had been shot in the chest, some in the head. I rushed back to the workers' headquarters. Though I was really scared, I still managed to burn all the membership lists.
By now, many people, no one knows how many, had been killed or wounded. So far, most of the casualties were bystanders and people blocking the advance of the troops. Having surrounded Tiananmen Square, the soldiers halted and awaited further orders. When taunted by the crowd, they fired.
At around 3 o'clock in the morning, several thousand students sat down at the monument. They wanted to stay to the very end. A lot of blood had already been shed that night, but most of the students in the square hadn't seen anything, so they didn't know what to believe. Everyone imagined that the soldiers would try to drive us away with clubs, and we would just sit there without budging and let the blood flow.
Some students handed me a big padded coat and a helmet and said, "Mr. Ho, you're too skinny. You won't be able to stand big clubs or rubber bullets. Here, use this coat for padding." Everyone thought they'd only use rubber bullets. Then sometime after 2 o'clock, a couple of doctors and students came running back to the monument and told us that the soldiers were using real bullets.
Things were getting more tense all the time. Many workers whose friends had been killed in the streets gathered at the monument. They were very angry and cried, "You students can talk about nonviolence all you want, but our brothers and sisters have been killed.
They pulled knives on us and told us to shut up.
One guy had a semi-automatic rifle. Some student guards and I took it from him. I was terrified. If any gunshots were fired from the monument, the troops would have had an excuse to gun everybody down. So I tried to smash it on the marble railing of the monument.
The students at the monument faced a dilemma. If they stayed and resisted, many might be killed. But if they left, would they be betraying the many workers and citizens who had already died to protect them and support their stand?
We heard Chai Ling's voice over the loudspeaker. She said those who want to leave should leave, and those who want to stay should stay. Chai Ling wanted to stay. We felt that Chai Ling's approach might be disastrous. People who wanted to leave couldn't do so safely, and those who stayed would be left in greater danger.
We came up with a plan to negotiate with the troops. We thought we should send two people and ask Chai Ling to send another two representatives from the student headquarters. Together, we would ask the army to give us enough time to leave the square.
At around 3:30, the four people on the hunger strike came to talk to the students. They said, blood is being spilled all over the city. More than enough blood has already been shed to awaken the people. We know you're not afraid of dying, but leaving now doesn't mean that you're cowards.
Chai Ling told us she had heard that leading government reformers hoped that the students would stay on the square until daybreak. So Liu Xiaobo told her, I don't care if it's true or not, but no leader has the right to gamble with thousands of students' lives at the square.
Finally, our student headquarters told them, you can go ahead and negotiate, but you can't represent us.
So we went ourselves. We got into a van and drove only a few seconds before we saw the soldiers, all lined up on Chang'an Avenue. As we got closer, the soldiers pointed their guns at us. They didn't know what we were up to. A few minutes later, an officer appeared. He listened to what we had to say and went to report to his superiors. He came back and told us that they had agreed to our request. He said, we hope you can convince the students to leave the square. We rushed back to the monument to tell the students. Their opinions were divided.
There was little time to debate. The troops sequestered in the nearby Great Hall of the People now came out and moved toward the monument. Soldiers with guns at the ready converged on the students from all directions.
The soldiers came right up in front of us. They were in full battle gear. The students all stood up. I was in the front row with a gun pointing straight at my chest. It was only a few inches away. The soldiers looked really mean. At the time, I was simply stunned. I didn't feel a thing. I can't imagine what would have happened had they really opened fire.
I was in charge of the vote to determine whether we should leave. I said, on the count of three, those who want to go, shout go. Those who want to stay, shout stay. I couldn't tell which side was louder.
I knew those who wanted to leave would be ashamed to shout very loud, while those who wanted to stay would shout with all their might.
Because of this situation, I felt that when the two sides sounded about the same, most likely more people voted to leave. So I announced the decision to leave.
Thank you.
At dawn on June 4th, after occupying the square for more than 3 weeks, all the remaining students and their teachers and supporters left Tiananmen Square. Tiananmen Square was empty, but skirmishes between the people and the army went on sporadically for several days. There were more deaths on both sides.
We filed out of the square from the southeast corner. I was near the end of the line. When we turned the corner at the concert hall, several tanks came up from behind. Suddenly, we heard shouts of panic. We looked back and saw people scrambling to get away as a tank turned around right in the middle of the crowd. Then we heard screaming and crying. We ran as fast as we could, afraid that the tank was going to run over us. A student I knew, he was not from my university, practically crawled out from under the tank. Two of his classmates were crushed.
His father and I waited at the university gate all night. At about 6 in the morning, one of his classmates came back and told us that around 11 o'clock, he'd been hit by a bullet and had bled a lot. He didn't know which hospital my son had been taken to. I knew I'd never see him alive again. Ever since April, when the first wall posters appeared on campus, I sensed that something terrible might happen. And finally, it did. It happened to me, a person who had always tried to avoid trouble. I lost my son.
Within a week of June 4th, the army was firmly in control of the city. The government then began a much harder job, reestablishing its authority and credibility. Arrests began immediately. Those caught throwing rocks at the troops or setting fire to army vehicles were tried and summarily executed. The government compiled wanted lists of leading participants in the movement. Pictures of the 21 most wanted activists were shown repeatedly on TV.
When the most wanted list was broadcast, I was on a boat bound for Nanjing. I wasn't the kind of person who could take life on the run. I wanted to return to Beijing and hide because I had so many friends there. I thought, if I got arrested, so be it. As soon as I came back to Beijing, they got me.
Despite her efforts to dissuade students from prolonged street action, Dai Qing was among those arrested. She was jailed for 10 months.
戴晴、于浩成、李陀等12人亲自到现场督阵，给动乱火上加油。
The crime of counter-revolution is very peculiar. What counts is not your actions, but your intention. I said, my intention was to help our country democratize. But they said everything you did shows that your intention was to overthrow the government, so you're a counter-revolutionary. Case closed.
When I was in jail, I debated with my interrogators. They insisted that the movement was premeditated and well-planned. I told them it wasn't. I said that if conditions existed in our country for people to premeditate and plan such a huge movement, then the Communist Party would have been long gone, vanished without a trace.
Liu Xiaobo, the teacher and critic who took part in the final hunger strike, was jailed for 21 months. When I left, I thought I would never see my daughter again. She stood in the doorway. She grabbed my clothes. So I played with her and said, bye-bye. No one else was at home. If my mother knew I was leaving, she would never have let me go. I slipped out when she went out to do the shopping. I said to my daughter, say bye-bye to Mama, and pretended not to be sad.
After I left Beijing, I was among farmers. They said to me, son, don't be afraid. We'll hide you now just like we hid the communists during the war against Japan. Back then, weren't the Japanese all powerful? And we didn't let them find the communists. And now the communists are all powerful. But we'll never let them find you.
Almost as soon as the struggle over Tiananmen Square ended, the struggle over the story of what happened there began. The official account was this. No one had died during the clearing of the square at dawn on June 4th. In the approaches to the square, some ruffians who had incited counter-revolutionary violence had been killed, as had a small number of innocent bystanders. The government went to extraordinary lengths to hunt down and punish anyone whose story strayed from the official line. One outraged bystander telling atrocity stories to a crowd was interviewed by ABC News. The Chinese government intercepted the satellite relay and used part of the interview in a nationwide broadcast. It called on informers to turn the man in. He was spotted in his hometown, hundreds of miles from Beijing. Xiaobin was sentenced to 10 years in prison. His case was a warning to all.
There was only one correct version of events, the government's version. Protesters who had been at the square gave differing accounts of what had happened. Chai Ling, hiding somewhere in China, sent her story out via Hong Kong.
And now here is the full 40-minute message in which Chai Ling recounts what happened between June 3rd and June the 4th.
我是柴林，导一天门指挥部总指挥，我还活着。这6月2号，到6月4号，这段时间，整个广岭的情况，我想我是最有资格的评论家。可是，我们事后才知道，仍然有一些同学，他们对这个政府、对这支军队还抱有希望。 他们以为顶多是军队把大家强行的架走，他们太疲劳了，还在帐篷里酣睡的时候，坦克已经把他们碾成肉饼。有人说同学死了200多。 也有人讲，整个广场已经死了4000多，具体的数字到现在我们也不知道。很多人说，广场上曾经
Some people said the 200 died in the square, and others claimed the 2,000 died there.
在广场上有坦克。
There are also stories of tanks in the square running over students who were trying to leave. I have to say that I did not see any of that. I don't know where those people did. I myself was in the square until 6:30 in the morning. I kept thinking, are we going to use lies to attack an enemy who lies? Aren't facts powerful enough? To tell lies against our enemy's lies only satisfies our need to vent our anger. But it's a dangerous thing to do. Maybe your lies will be exposed, and you'll be powerless to fight your enemy.
Chai Ling's 40-minute message ended with a call for the Chinese people to rise up.
也就要诞生了，民主存亡。最后的关头已经到来了，同胞们觉醒起来吧！打倒法西斯，打倒军人统治，人民必胜。
There was no mass uprising. In the weeks after June 4th, the government tried to clean away the evidence of the movement and its suppression. People stopped talking publicly about what they had seen and done in the spring of 1989.
At one point, everyone got involved in the movement. Even many party organizations took part. But as soon as it became clear that the government was in control, the movement disappeared as quickly as it had emerged. So many people started saying the opposite of what they really thought, and they rationalized it. I have no choice but to go along. This situation is not essentially different from what happened at the height of the movement. Words became more radical day by day, actions more irresponsible. Because in a crowd, no one felt the need to take individual responsibility. And when the tide suddenly turned, they didn't have the inner strength to stand by what they had said. These two extremes are actually two sides of the same coin.
The legacy of the movement at Tiananmen is that it made us think. There are two ways of going about change. One is the large-scale mass movement, romantic and grand, which aims to solve major problems overnight. The other method is gradual, grassroots, solidly grounded. It looks for cracks in the system and introduces specific democratic practices which don't necessarily carry a big label saying democracy. Which one is more effective in changing China? In changing the course of Chinese history?
I compare the 1989 democracy movement to an unripe fruit.
People were so hungry that they were desperate. When they suddenly discovered a fruit, they pounced on it and swallowed it whole. Then they got a stomach ache and a bitter taste in the mouth. So should they have eaten the fruit? You can say they shouldn't have, but they were hungry. And if you say they should have, what they ate was still green, inedible.
Shortly after June 4th, Deng Xiaoping appeared on television to praise the army for its heroic efforts. Deng Xiaoping had presided over a decade of profound economic transformation, and he had many times shielded reform from the attacks of hardliners. Even after the crackdown of 1989, he would continue to push for reforms. More than once, Deng had suffered from the absolute power wielded by top leaders in China. But his reforms stopped short of limiting his own power, for good and for evil. Faced with a crisis, he reached for the old weapons. Deng may have wanted to be remembered as a man who understood the needs of the Chinese people, the grand architect of reform. But the Beijing massacre will forever be a part of his legacy. In the government's account, Tiananmen Square was now returned to the people. Once again, the revolution had been sanctified by the blood of martyrs. State ceremonies paid tribute to the soldiers who died and honored their families.
All this talk about children being the flowers of the motherland, the hope of the nation, it's all for show. When they feel that it's in the interest of the party and the state, they bring on the bayonets, machine guns, and tanks. I can't watch any of that stuff on TV. It hurts too much. A life is a life. Why are people treated so differently? All my son asked for was a little equality, a little freedom, and it cost him his life.
Communism was once a shared ideal, held in the face of oppression and injustice. The actual political and social systems built in its name fell far short of its promise. For a long time before the killings in Beijing, communism was losing credibility around the world. It no longer grips the minds and imaginations of the Chinese people. But the Communist Party has not thereby lost its power. Power without faith leaves a vacuum that can quickly fill with anger, resentment, and despair.
Just like
After my son's death, I became suicidal. I had to struggle to get through each day. I thought about other mothers like myself and young wives who'd lost their husbands, young children who'd lost their fathers. I wanted to look for them so that we could give each other comfort and support. Should we simply wait for another chance to start a democracy movement like 1989? Would that save China? I don't think so. The only way to change our situation is for each one of us to make a personal effort. Every small action counts.
When people abandon hope for a perfect future and faith in great leaders, they are returned to the common dilemmas of humanity. And there, in personal responsibility, in civility, in making sacred the duties of ordinary life, another path may be found.
On the 100th day after my son's death, I brought his ashes back home. He's been here ever since. One day I want him to be buried with the others who fell with him. I'm hoping that day will come, and I'm working towards it.
Thank you. 六四刚一过的时候就有这个想法。其实，在运动发生和发展的过程中，有不少人非常兴高采烈地说这个运动非常值得一个很有意义的事情，应该有人拍什么的。但是我们没有去国内拍，有一些人马上就旅行到北京去，到北京去拍了。我们没有这样，是完了之后，感到有必要拍一个东西。实际上我也不是最开始也不是我的主意，是一些朋友来找我和我先生，因为我们过去拍过其他的有关中国的片子。那个时候我很犹豫，因为我觉得这个片子不好拍。我们看到在西方报道的这次事件，完全是一边倒的，而且是很简单的黑白分明的，几乎没有一个中国人说出一句完整的话，基本上中国人被当作一个背景，真正的英雄是美国的主播。我在美国看到的是这样的。我自己因为在国内也有好多朋友，实际上他们也有很多不同的观点，我认识的人也没有很多不同的观点，所以我知道中国的事情要复杂得多。如果我们按照很精确的很确实的拍这样一部历史，而且有不同的声音出来，我想我就几方面都不讨好，谁都认为我没有完全符合他的这个说法或者他的认识，所以我觉得压力很大，所以我犹豫了很久才决定要拍的。也是相当相当报道的很多。我记得那个时候我还在教书，在威斯里大学教书，我除了上课的时间，我基本上全都是在看电视。我当时就录下来了十几盘，当时比如 CNN 和其他美国主要媒体的报道，我很难说，就是估计基本上也是每半小时，在 CNN 或者其他一些节目上，基本上每半小时就有一轮新的报道，相当多。有人统计过，在1989年，对于这个事件，这个几个星期之内，中国在美国电视上出现的总时数超过过去10年的总时数，所以说这个还是人们主要对中国的印象还是通过那几个星期，这个10年的各种铺垫，各种比较复杂的进程，美国人了解的很少。我其实估计到了，因为我拍过其他的纪录片，我们拍的纪录片都是很难的，当然这个难度就更大。我们拍的其他纪录片，要是你想拍的比较深，不去随着一些电视的模式去拍，你光筹钱就费很大的劲，然后你又得在剪接的过程中都考虑到很多很多事情，拍摄的时候也尽量拍摄到很多很多材料，从这里面取材，不会说拍那么一两天就觉得你把什么都把握了，然后粗制滥造放在一起。我们每拍一个片子都是经历了很长的时间，从筹款到制作，而且我觉得这很难把握。我不知道现在就是这种很复杂的有关政治的这种事件，你拍起来很难把握。我觉得你很难把这个事情表述的恰如其分。我自己的判断可能会有错误，这个时候对参与的人都是不公平的，所以你要做我就有很重的心理负担。我觉得不光是一个我做出来随便做出来别人骂不骂我的问题，别人不骂我，如果我做错了，我自己会很谴责我自己的。Yeah, 我们其实主要的拍摄还是在美国进行的，回到国内去拍摄非常不容易。一方面是这个气氛，对吧？我们没有办法做很多的事情。另一方面，我觉得我们要是稍有不慎，也会给被采访的人带来很多麻烦。所以这个也都是电影的一些局限性。如果说我们有充分的机会去愿意和谁谈就和谁谈，也可能这个电影又会一些其他的面貌或者其他的补充的材料人物等等。我们是在一种很有限的条件下拍的。我们回北京拍的时候，基本上就是在美国已经采访了很多人，而且我们读了很大量的资料，又和更广泛的在北京和更广泛的人在私下里都谈了，最后呢选那么两三个最值得谈的谈，尽量人数少一点，因为在国内不好做了很多。 斯以后，各种说法是满天飞，说什么的都有。你比方说，西班牙电视台，他们有一个摄制组，就在天安门，就是长安街一直到天安门到纪念碑中心，一直待到六四凌晨，甚至学生撤退的时候，他们一直跟着学生一起拍的。但是当天他们马上把他们拍的东西都送回西班牙以后，在西班牙电视台的人并不知道这个北京的地理哪一块地方发生的什么事情，他们就是有一个大家有一个意念，就是那个时候天安门广场发生了屠杀，于是呢他们就找出最血淋淋的场面，都说是天安门广场中心发生的事情。事后也有人跟他们质疑这个，他们说那是因为回去剪接的人不知道怎么回事，反正就听说天安门广场杀人了，那么图像在哪儿就找，一跑这些个片子看哪儿那个最血淋淋，就把哪儿放上去啊，这是天安门广场。实际上那可能离广场相当远的地方，在街上老百姓这个阻挡军队向前开的时候发生的事情，但是他们都堆到天安门广场。所以我们拍这个片子的时候，我们就分不清到底哪些是事实，哪些是谣言。而且有些事实或者有些谣言，他制造的人呢，他是有一定的对他自己有一定的好处的。当然我觉得政府用军队来对付一个和平的抗议，这个无论如何是不对的。但是这个哪些人付出了牺牲，哪些人没有付出牺牲，对于一个严谨的历史记录来讲非常重要。特别是当有一些没有付出牺牲的人，他在事后出来说自己是付出了牺牲，说自己是枪林弹雨里面出来的，怎么样，这个实际上我觉得是对那些真正付出了生命和付出了受了伤的人，实际上是很不公平的。所以我一定要把事实弄得很清楚。另一方面，我想这个夸大的这种言论对于中国政府也不公平，即使他做错了，我们对他也要公平。我觉得任何一种谎言，不管出自什么人，出自什么目的，它都不是好的，都是在历史上站不住脚的，而且不可能对建设一个更好的社会做出任何贡献，只能有坏的影响，没有好的影响。这是我很深深的相信的一个原则。所以那个时候呢，我这个话说得远了，就说到梁小燕。有很多这种说在天安门广场中心拿机枪扫射学生这样的事情，都我们经过广泛的查访知道这都不是事实。但是有一件事是不断的被人重复的，我们觉得有一点影子，这个事情可能是事实，就是说有坦克车在六部口，在长安街西长安街六部口压死了十几个人。那这件事情因为我们听到的各方的说法呢都比较一致，没有什么自相矛盾的地方。但是我还是不甘心，我听到一些我认为很负责任的人讲这个事情，但是他们也是听别人讲的，我就非要找到一个亲眼看到的人，所以我就不断地问是谁看见过，最后有人告诉我是梁小燕看见过，他听说梁小燕看见过。我是因为这个事情去找他，向他核实这个事情，问他是在什么情况下看到的，而他讲得非常负责任，他看到了多少，没看到多少，他离那个现场有多远等等，讲得非常非常详细。所以我而且他确实没有什么对他就是出于他自身的利益有什么可以需要说谎的这个动机，所以我就比较相信他说的。当然后来我也查访到一些其他的人都可以从这个佐证这个事情，但是我能够采访的只有梁小燕。别的人呢，一方面有的是觉得他们处境还是不太好，所以我就决定没有采访那些人。我就问梁小燕愿不愿意公开出来说这个话，因为说这个话实际上是需要很大的胆量的。那个时候政府还是承认有些什么观看的市民、旁观的市民被误伤什么的，政府没有否认有人被打死，基本是枪弹打死的。但是我想政府否认说绝对没有坦克车压人，那么这个话说了以后有人再说有，那他就可以拿你当什么来治你，对不对？很像肖斌的那个事情。所以我想他很实事求是的把他看到的东西愿意讲出来，这一点我就很佩服他。然后而且讲的时候丝毫没有夸大，我离那儿20几米，我是回头看到的，至于压死的什么人我没有亲眼看到，因为那个时候我们都吓得，就那有一个工地，他们就往墙上爬，很多男生一下蹭的就跳到墙头去了，他爬也爬不上去，那些男同学往上拉他，是那样一种非常慌乱的情景，因为后边这个坦克在人群里打了一个转。但是他也说是一队坦克沿着长安街开下去的，有其中有一辆忽然拐弯拐到边上，那么也说明这个事情呢是一种军事事故， 而不是说上面下命令让坦克车去压人的。不管是不是事故，是非常坏的一件事情，但是你又不能说是由此可见政府下命令让坦克去压人。我觉得这些结论都不可以随便下的，事实是怎么样就是怎么样。所以我是通过这个认识梁小燕。那当然有，当然有。实际上我是很矛盾的，在做这个过程中，一方面要想恢复这个历史的原貌，你必须有当事人的非常清楚的这种见证，但另一方面在中国大陆那种气氛下，在政府不允许不同声音出来，不但是不允许，而且还会迫害有不同声音的人的话，这就非常危险。对有一些人来讲，虽然他说的非常实事求是，没有任何夸大，只要他说的话是当时政府的这一下的这个这种结论与那个结论不符合的话，他就有可能被整。所以我也是非常矛盾的，一方面我希望有更多的人能够实事求是的把过程讲出来，一方面我也知道这样会给这些人造成个人的多么大的压力，他们会付出一些个人的牺牲，不同程度的牺牲，所以我也很难去要求人这样做。我只不过就是比如像梁显燕，我提出来，我说你可不可以说，他说我可以说，那时我很出乎意料的。像丁子霖呢，他因为已经说了，已经对外面说了，所以他继续要说下去，我觉得也是这样。所以像王丹，那么他已经入了监狱了，但是很多普通的人，虽然他们有很多非常精彩的故事，那就很不容易了。我们也采访了一些人，最后没有用，也有用这个就是投影的方式采访过一些人，最后因为显得有点太奇怪了，后来也或者他们讲的比较起来，可能相比起来，得不上失，就是用上这种投影的方式显得非常神秘，后来还有一些我采访的没用的，这个都有。当时我没怎么想完了以后会怎么样，反正我想可能是几头不讨好，但是我觉得我没有料到的是我们会被所谓民运，我说所谓就是我不大知道要称这个运动是什么，我觉得我不太知道民运是什么意思，我知道抗议是什么意思，而且我知道这个，我觉得这个运动它是针对很多中国社会和政治上面的弊病提出抗议，就是它不要什么很清楚，它要什么并不清楚，所以我觉得我更知道有定义比较清楚的说法就是抗议运动，那么我就管他们叫抗议运动的领袖吧，一些个被西方媒体捧出来的一些人，我想他们肯定因为我这影片不是在表现他们伟大光荣正确的历史，而是在分析这个政治过程中的各种复杂的情况，他们肯定他们需要吹捧，真的是需要吹捧，所以我想他们肯定会不会太满意，但是我想我也没想到他们会使用和共产党那么相似的语言来谴责我们，这个我是有点没有料到，我都最后我只能笑，因为太可笑了。最后就是说我们是什么，我们是一群，说那个天安门影片的制作人是一群苍蝇，是我们这个时代的真正疾病，哎呀我们就笑死了，后来我们在办公室里后来就呼称苍蝇同志。
1989年6月4日，中国政府出动军队，武力推散在天安门广场绝食静坐的数以万计的示威学生，因而引发众多民众死亡的惨剧。这件就是六四事件，一件至今仍未得到公平处理的事件。究竟六四事件是怎样发生的呢？那就要从70年代的时代背景讲起了。首先是经济方面的情况。1976年，毛泽东逝世，翌年四人帮被打倒，由邓小平主导的时代正式展开，亦标志着经济改革时代的来临。究竟当时中国的经济改革带来了什么后果呢？改革开放令市场变得活跃，随着私营企业的出现和外国资本的引入，部分城市人开始富有起来，但伴随而来的恶果就是贫富悬殊加剧和官吏贪污腐败。六四前夕，人民所喊的正是反贪污、反腐化、反官倒等口号。其次，当时的国内和国际的政治环境 亦有助于促使六四事件的发生。在国内方面，随着邓小平上场，政治环境亦渐趋宽松。邓小平曾先后扶植胡耀邦、赵紫阳等改革派人物，担当国家的领导人，主力发展经济改革。而胡耀邦和赵紫阳亦是思想比较开放的人，于是对政治的钳制就开始放松了，人民亦开始更大胆地表达自己的意见。在国际方面，1985年戈尔巴乔夫出任世界第一共产大国苏联的领导人，开始逐步推行政治和经济的改革。一时之间，在世界各地的共产世界里面，政治气氛亦变得宽松起来，对人民的思想钳制开始放松。但是引发六四事件的导火线，就要讲到胡耀邦的逝世了。1989年4月15日，积极支持改革的前中共总书记胡耀邦逝世，北京大学立刻出现大批悼念胡的大字报。学生和民众藉着悼念胡耀邦，表达对政府的不满，要求加速中国民主的步伐。4月18日凌晨，大约6000名学生由北京大学游行到天安门，高呼要求民主。两日后，南京、上海、天津、合肥、武汉等城市均有游行，中共声称要严惩示威者。4月21日，10万人聚集于天安门广场，公然违抗政府的清场公告。4月22日，政府举行胡耀邦追悼会，100万市民夹道送别胡耀邦的灵柩，三名学生在人民大会堂前跪了多个小时请愿，要求同政府对话，但是政府始终没有人出来接收请愿书。翌日，北京临时学生会联合会号召罢课，并组织学生上街演讲，又自办报纸。但是官方的《人民日报》在4月26日的社论回应的竟然是要旗帜鲜明地反对动乱，咁无疑系令事件火上加油，结果就爆发咗北京有史以嚟最大规模嘅自发性大游行同大绝食。4月27日，学生发动50万人大游行，要求同政府对话，其后又有五四纪念日大游行，首次有学生以外嘅新闻工作者加入。5月13日，数千名学生在天安门广场绝食静坐，抗议政府拖延不肯对话。5日后，国务院总理李鹏终于同学生领袖吴尔开希等举行了一次对话，但是只是各说各话，并没有结果。5月19日，当时仍然是中共总书记的赵紫阳到天安门广场劝学生停止绝食，声泪俱下。学生因此想暂停绝食，但是不久就传来国务院总理李鹏要强硬对付动乱的电视发言，20万学生立刻宣布同时绝食。5月20日，北京政府宣布戒严，但是奉命前往执行戒严令的外地军队却被数以十万计的北京市民锁阻，未能入城。5月23日，戒严的第四日，反而激发起有史以来北京最多人自发性的100万市民大游行。5月30日，学生在天安门广场竖起了自己制作的民主女神像。我们回头看看香港的情况是怎样。5月20日，八号风球高原，4万名市民在风雨交加之下在维多利亚公园集会，并冒雨游行到中国驻港机构新华社门外，抗议北京的戒严令。翌日，香港出现了有史以来最大规模的100万人大游行， 同日并成立了香港市民支援爱国民主运动联合会，简称支联会。5月27日，全港演艺界人士在跑马地马场举行12小时马拉松演唱会《民主歌声献中华》，四台同时直播，共筹得1300多万元，拨作支联会基金。5月28日，全世界各大城市的中国人都举行了大游行，声援中国学生。这些城市包括了北京、上海、广州、台北、高雄、香港、澳门、大阪、三藩市、洛杉矶、温哥华、悉尼、伦敦、巴黎等等。香港的游行人数达150万人，是全球之冠，亦是香港的纪录。事件发展到达了高潮，同时亦接近尾声。执迷不悟的中国政府终于将事件推向了悲剧。1989年6月4日是中国现代史上黑暗的一日。在凌晨时分，中共军队强行闯入北京市区，沿途将挡住去路的北京市民用枪射杀，同用坦克剪毙。最后坦克驶入了天安门广场，学生被迫撤走，广场到处弹痕累累，连人民英雄纪念碑亦满布弹孔。在一片腥风血雨之中，数以千计的市民和学生惨遭屠杀。枪声和救护车的悲鸣声彻夜响遍了整条长安大街。6月4日清晨，军队已基本上控制了北京城，再没有示威，再没有游行，再没有绝食，有的只是坦克、军队和枪声。这一切一切，我们都能够从电视台的直播和记者传回来的照片看得清清楚楚。一场悲壮的学生运动就在暴力镇压中落幕。事后国务院发言人袁穆竟然说六四镇压当日只是死了25人，其后又再改口说死了300人，并再次清楚地将这次事件定性为反革命暴乱。中国政府在这次事件中得到的教训是要将所有反对的声音在星星之火的阶段就立刻扑灭，不要再让它有任何燎原的机会。政治环境虽然收窄了，但是为了要平息人民的怨愤，就要继续大力发展经济，让部分人民继续富起来。但是这样贫富悬殊的情况不单止没有得到改善，反而越来越严重。民主运动严重受挫，曾一度出现局部的言论自由，再度受到压抑，民主运动要转到地下发展。民运人士至今仍花果飘零地流亡海外。有儿子被杀的母亲组织了天安门母亲行动，为事件中无辜被杀的人寻求公义。人民的希望落空，转而指向金钱至上的物质生活追求，于是人民的精神质素越来越低，可以为了赚钱而不顾他人死活。中国的民主化和现代化仍有漫漫长路。